Before starting my talk, I would like to apologize for my English, which will have a strong Dutch accent. We have a whole range of accents this morning. This will end with Brexit, of course. Jean-Claude Juncker has already promised that importance of English will diminish in the European Union. So within a few years, we're all talking Dutch and German and French here. I would also like to thank the organizers of this workshop, Nicolas, Felipe, Maria Cruz, for having me here, quite surprisingly, because I am actually working on images, but in a whole other context, a very different context. Today, I will talk about Protestantism. At least we have some connection with the theme of the workshop. And more in particular, the way the Inquisition and Protestantism influenced each other in Spain during the 16th century. Not so much the influence of the Inquisition on Protestantism, because we all know how this story ended. The Inquisition rooted out Protestantism in the 16th century, but the influence of Protestantism on the Inquisition. Did the Inquisition change when Protestantism became one of its major heresies, one of the major heresies they had to prosecute? And as a starting point, I would like to begin with the image of the Inquisition depicted by the Black Legend. Most of you, I suppose, know what the Black Legend is. The Inquisition is very important. Some of you are working even on the Black Legend. The Inquisition is a very important part of this Black Legend from the 1560s on. This is one of the first engravings, a Dutch engraving, Klaas Visscher, of the Auto de Fe of Valladolid, and that's the first time that in Northern Europe people become aware of the Inquisition. The Inquisition at that moment exists already for 80 years, but is quite anonymous in the North. That's with the repression of Protestants in Spain that the Inquisition becomes part of the Black Legend in Northern Europe. And the image of the Black Legend, the image of the Inquisition in this Black Legend is an image of a society dominated by an institution, a powerful, very powerful institution that reigns by fear. Even a very important French Hispanist, Bartolomé Benassar, has called it la pédagogie de la peur. You have this reign of fear, and out of fear, people collaborate with the Inquisition. So you have, and that's the third point of my title, you have a system of social control being the ways in which a society regulates the thoughts and behavior of its members. You have a formal system of social control, a system dominated by the state, and the state controlling directly its members and punishing the members that are opposing to the official ideology. Now, there are many arguments to refute this vision of fear, the vision that Spanish people would collaborate with the Inquisition out of fear. You have arguments on the administrative side. You have arguments in the daily life of the people. I think I even had some more examples. I'm sorry. This engraving, for example, returns very frequently. You have it in, this is a Dutch version, but with the text. The text might be in Dutch, in German, in French. You have them in German, and there is also a Latin edition, but I didn't find any pictures. And this is what you get in the 17th, 18th century. This is the image of the Inquisition we have usually, and even in manuals today, actual manuals still repeat this image. Curiously, in the 19th century, all those people that are tortured on these engravings are replaced by beautiful naked women in the 19th century. But my point was there are many arguments against this vision of the Inquisition as an instrument of fear. First place, if you take a look at the organization of the Inquisition, this is a map of all the districts around, of all the final districts, because the district of Madrid is already present. But this is more or less a situation around 1550. You have 15 districts on the Iberian Peninsula, and they're covering the whole of the territory. Now, every district in the middle of 16th century had two inquisitors. So that means that about 30 inquisitors are trying to dominate the territory, the whole territory of Spain. Now, if you see at some of those districts, district of Valladolid in 1550 is huge because Santiago de Compostela didn't exist at that moment. So you had a very huge district. And some of those districts have a population over half a million of people, some of them even almost a million of inhabitants. So it's quite impossible to think that a tribunal with two judges in the middle of the 16th century would dominate this territory or would be able to inspire fear in the whole of its territory. When you're living in the north of Spain, you never saw an inquisitor in your life, probably. So Inquisition is something very far away. It's in the district capital, and of course Inquisition visits the district sometimes, but there are places where they never show up, so where this fear is quite relative. Now you would say the Black Legend also talks about a whole network of spies, the so-called familiares. They are present in every village and in every town of the peninsula, and they are the ones that take the control of society. They are the ones that detect heresy. They are the ones that denounce heresies, not so much the inquisitors, but these familiares. Now, if you take a look at the network of familiares, it's a very dense network. Some of those districts have 2,000 familiares. But then familiares weren't clerics. They were ordinary people. They were farmers. They were craftsmen. They weren't clerics at all. And as ordinary people, they weren't trained by the Inquisition to detect heresy. So they weren't, their purpose was not detecting heresy. We even have examples of familiares being Protestants themselves in one case, or familiares having employees, Protestant employees, during 5-6 years without noticing that they had a Protestant working in their own home. And so when they are arrested, inquisitors ask them, well, this person has been working with you 5 years and you didn't notice that he was a Protestant. How is this possible? So this network of familiares has other purposes, not purpose of detecting heresy. That's one of the major arguments. Other arguments would be that the Cortes of Castile, as well as Aragon, at least during the first half of the 16th century, is quite critical institutions, and during the first reigns of the emperor, they oppose quite frequently to the imperial policy. The Cortes never asked for a suppression of the Inquisition. They asked for reformation of the Inquisition because Inquisition violated local privileges, but they never asked for a suppression. Even during the War of the Comuneros, only a limited sector of Spanish society asked for a suppression of the Inquisition. Another argument would be that during the whole history of the Inquisition, there are many conflicts of jurisdiction between the Inquisition and other institutions. Now, the general image of the Inquisition by the Black Legend is an image of a powerful institution, so powerful that even the king is a puppet of the Inquisition. And the king comes to the autos de fe, and the king merely is a puppet in the hands of the inquisitors. So how can you explain then those conflicts of jurisdiction between all these institutions and the Inquisition itself, and conflicts over for example, when I'm a member of the Inquisition, I have the right to appear before the Inquisition. So when I steal something from you, I will go to trial before the Inquisition. And when you steal something from me, you will go to trial before the Inquisition. And that raises a whole question of jurisdictional conflicts, because other institutions doubt this privilege of the Inquisition. On a lower level, you find during the 16th century at least many examples of physical violence against the inquisitors and against members of the Inquisition. Most important example probably is the case of Antonio Pérez, who was arrested for Protestantism in Zaragoza and was liberated by the people of Zaragoza, was taken out of dungeons of the Inquisition. But it's not the only example. We have an example of the Canary Island at the end of the 16th century, where people are menacing the commissioners and the familiares of the Inquisition and telling them not to detain the Dutch and the German merchants that are bringing stuff to the Canary Islands, and if they would do it, they would burn their houses. So that's quite an significant menace to a member of the Inquisition itself. You have many examples of verbal aggression against against members of the Inquisition. And again, one of the most striking examples is in the Canary Islands, where at a certain moment, so the Inquisition every year, inquisitors go to the Cathedral of Las Palmas and they read the Edicto de Fe, and the prosecutor of the Tribunal of Las Palmas had a very bad handwriting, so he started reading and he couldn't read anymore what he had written, and so people started laughing, started insulting the tribunal, and in the end, the inquisitors got out of the church together with the prosecutor. So all those are images that really don't match with this image of fear. And the last argument would be the enormous number of false denunciations. Now, Inquisition was very severe against people denouncing falsely other people. So if you would denounce your neighbor and would be a false denunciation, you would severely punished. In spite of this punishment, you have still, during the 16th century, and in case of Protestants, between 10 and 15% of all the denouncements are false during the 16th century. So that's a whole other image of the Inquisition. There is no fear. There would be probably fear between the conversos, of course. They had to fear Inquisition because they were the object of persecution. But at least between all Christians, you don't find this image of fear. So the main point I would like to discuss today is how did the Inquisition convince people to denounce other people, and how did the system evolve during the 16th century under the influence of Protestantism and the Counter-Reformation. So very briefly, I would like to return to the beginning to explain more or less what's the situation at the beginning of the 16th century. And in the Middle Ages, you had in Spain the regime of convivencia, what's called convivencia, kind of peaceful society with the three religions, a society of segregation. I compare it to apartheid, maybe. Before it was a reference, but now young people even don't know what apartheid is. So you have three groups separated from each other. There's no way, in practice, of course, they do mingle, but the official doctrine is that the three groups are completely separate, and this is a situation in the Middle Ages. Now, during the end of the 14th and the 15th century, this changes. You have in all of Europe an anti-Jewish climate, and also in Spain. There is an increasing pressure on the Jewish community and on the Muslim community as a collateral damage, because they attack both most. Generally the Jews, but at the same time in many cities also the Muslims. And you have this increasing pressure to convert. So during the 15th century, you get another situation. You get the three groups, and you have this two groups that are converted to Christianity, converted Jews, converted Muslims. Now, at the beginning, this seems to solve the problem. If you can create one big group of Christians, then you've solved the whole problem. But in fact, it didn't, because what happened was that the Jews, that in this system are powerful, of course, but they have a whole range of society where they can't infiltrate, and the church is inaccessible for Jews, the royal administration is inaccessible for Jews, the army is inaccessible for Jews. When they become Christians, they can participate, and they can enter in these sectors of society. So, for example, the first Inquisitor General was the son of a converso. Tomás de Torquemada was a converso, was the son of a converso himself. So, instead of having a solution for the problem aggravates and becomes worse. Because it's impossible, it becomes impossible to detain those judeo conversos, les moriscos. Moriscos are farmers in Valencia, in Andalusia, but above all the judeo conversos, you can't detain them anymore. And they are occupying positions in society which Jews could not occupy. And so you have, in the second half of the 15th century, a situation of almost endemic violence against Jewish and converso communities. Old Christians have problems with this system. They see that in spite of their reaction against the Jews and the Judeo conversos, they still maintain their powerful situation. And you have a situation of endemic violence. This is the list of attacks on Jewish ghettos in the second half of the 15th century and see that almost every year in some town in Castile, this is only Castile, not Aragon, community is invaded and people are forced to convert themselves. Sometimes one city, sometimes two, sometimes the whole kingdom. This is a very dangerous situation as a king. You can't allow really that every year you have violence in your kingdom. And that's when the Inquisition pops in. And Inquisition will be created as a solution to the violence in Castilian society at that moment. And this is a final, is the end point of the evolution. You get one big group of Christians. The Jews are expelled in 1492. Morsk is another story. Maybe we can discuss that later. But we have then this group of Christians, and the Inquisition is created in order to protect the external border of this group. Because one of the main points that frustrated old Christians was that many Jews converted to Christianity in order to get access. That's their interpretation. I'm not saying that it was like this, but their interpretation, in order to get access to these spheres of power, and and secretly adhere their old religion. So they were kind of hypocrites. And then the Inquisition is installed to avoid this. Inquisition would punish any converted Jew that would relapse to its former religion. And then the internal frontier, in order to have a solution for this friction between old and new Christians, the internal frontier is organized among the system of limpieza de sangre. In order to go to a university, in order to become part of the royal administration, you had to demonstrate that you had no Jewish or Muslim ancestors. And so you create a border between the two groups and you close those spheres of power again for the new Christian. This is the situation more or less around 1500. And it's the Inquisition who will control the limpieza de sangre. So if I have a son, he needs to go to university, I would ask for a certificate of limpieza de sangre, and the Inquisition would do the research. I would come to my village and would interrogate people. So final result is that the endemic violence in Castilian society, in Spanish society, disappears. People delegate the power to persecute the Jews, to convert the Jews to the Inquisition. And you find no violence anymore after the creation of the Inquisition. So we have here a system of formal social control. The state, so to say, the state having control over its population and punishing people that have deviant behavior. Now, what are the techniques in order to implement this formal control? First technique is the emphasis at the beginning on self-accusation. Inquisition would detect the groups susceptible to deviant behavior, would identify those groups, and would urge them to turn themselves in. At the first years of the Inquisition, the first edictos de fe there are emphasizing self-accusation. And the second technique is surveillance. Inquisition will surveil people convicted. Afterwards, they will surveil that they don't relapse. And so you have, on the one hand, self-accusation in order to get people with deviant behavior turn themselves in. And once they are punished, you have a system of control in order to avoid that they would relapse again. The main instruments to implement this self-accusation, stimulation of self-accusation, is the Edicto de Gracia, which is called. That's a document that it's read every year in every parish church of the country, urging people to denounce themselves. It's read during Lent in general, so when Christians are obliged to confess with their parish priests, they connect the confession, the element of confession, with the element of denunciation, of self-accusation. And the Edicto de Gracia is characterized by a period of 30 days in general, during which you get a benevolent treatment. If you if you incriminate yourself during the first 30 days of the Edicto de Gracia, you won't be burned. First place, your possessions won't be confiscated, and you get a benevolent treatment. So people at the beginning, people start self-incriminating themselves because during those 30 days you are sure of this benevolent treatment. Now you can shut up, you can hide your situation, but then you risk that your neighbor will incriminate himself, and maybe he will mention your name, and then of course you can't really have this benevolent treatment anymore, and then you're punished like any other heretic. So at the beginning of the Inquisition, you see that self accusations increase spectacularly. This is a genealogy people needed. It's in relation to the limpieza de sangre, a certificate you needed in order to get into these sectors of society. But this is the one I meant to show. Self-accusations. The number of self-accusations, we don't have them for all of the districts. They are studied for a few districts, among them the district of Valencia. And there you can clearly see Valencia was erected in 82. That first year's quite low numbers, but then it rapidly increases. So the system of self-incrimination is very important at the beginning. The system of surveillance from the beginning on is organized around a penitential garment people were obliged to wear, the sanbenito. So when you were convicted by the Inquisition, every time you left your house, in your house you could do whatever you wanted, but when you got out, you needed to put this penitential garment on so that everybody in your community could see that you were a person convicted by the Inquisition and could more or less surveil your behavior, and maybe if you would relapse, go to the inquisitors to tell them to accuse you again. And then the last technique of surveillance is the visits to the district. Inquisitors at the beginning of the Inquisition visit their district. They visit, in theory, every village and every town every year. In practice, they will visit the villages where they had identified converso community, Jewish community before. So this is more or less a system at the beginning, a formal system of social control organized by the Inquisition, directly surveilling the members of society. Now, all this changed around 1500. Benasar, there were less, after 1500, you have less conversos that were accused. Benasar speaks about running out of fuel. There were no converted Jews anymore that were relapsing. The Moriscos become a problem, but they get a kind of 40 years period where they may adapt. So they, I think it was in 1526 that they get this this privilege to 40 years. And then, of course, in 66, 67, you have the problems in the Alpujarras when after 40 years the king demands integration, and they didn't integrate. So that's one part. You have less people from the Jewish and the converso communities or the Morisco communities relapsing to their old faith. And you have, at the same time, the new heresies that become more important. Alumbrados, mysticism, illuminists, I suppose, in English. Erasmianists, Lutheranos, whatever. All of those new sects that arise in the first half of the 16th century, and that become more important. Now, it seems quite drastic change from Jews and conversos to Lutherans, but at the beginning it didn't. For the Inquisition, it was a logical step, and the Inquisition during many years believed that Lutheranism was a kind of invention of the Jews to attack the Catholic Church, and that Luther was a Jew himself. That's a very common image in the first half of the 16th century. And then, of course, that's a byproduct of Protestantism. When the Counter-Reformation starts, when the Council of Trent implements a whole series of measures, then you have the new offenses, moral offenses, that will become part of the jurisdiction of the Inquisition. And so from the 1560s, Inquisition starts to persecute bigamy, homosexuality, bestiality, witchcraft, heretical propositions such as the simple fornication, the idea that to sleep with a woman that was not married was not a sin, blasphemy, doubting the Holy Virgin's virginity, transubstantiation, confessors who sexually molested their female confessants. They're all part of a new set of heresies that are that become part of the jurisdiction of the Inquisition. Now, what is the difference with the first set of heresies? Those new groups are not well defined in society. You had, in the 15th century, you had the Jewish communities, Muslim communities, the converso communities, that were more or less defined. People more or less knew in which villages, in which towns there was a Jewish community or there was a converso community. Now, new heresies all were not a question of new Christians alone, no, all Christians too, any Spaniard. In fact, the idea of simple fornicación was a very popular heresy in Spain in the second half of the 16th century. So now you change, you're not only persecuting new Christians, but also old Christians. And then, of course, those are very, that's much more difficult to identify the groups. There could be anyone. Anyone could be thinking of this simple fornicación. While before, at least they had to be conversos or of Jewish origin. They were also very difficult to localize. You see the visits of the Inquisition at the beginning of its existence, they go to the villages where they know conversos and Jews are living, and they don't visit the villages where they're only old Christians. They never visited those villages. Now, the new heresies, they're all over the place. They could pop up in every place of district. Another difference is that there is no collective memory of those new groups. You have these old groups, and in the village, probably everybody knows that Juan is a descendant of Jews and that his grandfather converted to Christianity. Here, there is a lack of memory, and this, which is also a difficulty to identify those group. And I suppose, above all, the main difference between these new Christians and these old Christians is that the old Christians are not, of course, not convinced of their deviant behavior. And many people trialed before the Inquisition, they really are surprised that they are trialed because they believe that it is not a sin to sleep with an unmarried woman. They're not convinced. Self-incrimination becomes becomes less likely because they're not convinced of their own crime. And in second place, there is a complete absence of any feelings of hostility towards the new group, towards the old groups, of course. Old Christians hated, it's a caricature, but a simplification maybe, but there was old Christian converses and Jews were hated by the others, and you had this we-they situation. With these new heresies, you had a complete absence of these feelings because the one uttering those crimes, those moral offenses, could be my neighbor, could be my best friend. And there's complete absence of group hostility towards those new groups. So the problem is now for the Inquisition, how do we stimulate people to denounce not the Jew, or not the converso, not the enemy of the enemy, the traditional enemy? How do we convince them to accuse their neighbors? That's the biggest problem. And so you see a shift during the 16th century from self-accusation at the beginning to accusation at the end of the 16th century. The Edicto de Gracia keeps on existing. It becomes the Edicto de Fe. I think I have an example, one of Lima, the end of the 18th century. It becomes an Edicto de Fe, and the period of grace disappears. You get no benevolent treatment anymore because the emphasis is on accusation. The Inquisition wants to stimulate people to accuse others, to vigilate and to accuse their neighbors. So it's the same system. It's read annually in every parish church. But there is no period of grace anymore. or urged to accuse anybody you know of that's heretic during the 30 days. If not, you have problems, but you don't get any benevolent treatment anymore. And then this edicto de fe is completed with another edict, the edicto de anatema. That's something new that pops up at the end of the 16th century. And that's the edict the inquisitors would read at the end of the period of 30 days. Now you get 30 days, and within those 30 days you have to accuse the people you know of that are heretics. If you don't do, at the edict expires, inquisitors read the edicto de anatema. And then you get, this edict stipulates major excommunication for everybody knowing of heresies in society and not denouncing them. So now you're arranging a problem for yourself. If you don't accuse people you know of heresy, then you get in problems. Not they, but you get in problems. Your major excommunication basically means that when you die at that moment, you can't get to heaven anymore. And you end up in hell. And those edictos de anatemas, they contain a series of terrifying curses. If you're looking, if you want to stalk this afternoon somebody on Twitter or Facebook, maybe you can make use of those type of fragments. They're terrifying curses. And in the end, they're, may your wives be widows and your children orphans. So that's kind of inspiring element to start accusing people in your environment. So now you get a situation where, of course, the heretics are excluded anyway, but where people, not being heretic themselves, are excluded from Christian community also when they don't denounce. So the emphasis is on accusation in the second half of the 16th century. In order to facilitate accusation, you need to build new strictures, structures, and you need to receive those accusations, you need to do research and to put those people on trial. And then you get a series of changes in the inquisitorial bureaucracy. The visits fall into disuse. No inquisitor in the second half of the 16th century is visiting his district anymore. They don't visit their districts. Instead, they get a third inquisitor. Every district gets a third inquisitor in order to manage the accusations, in order to start trials, in order to finish the trials. You get the creation of the Tribunal of Santiago de Compostela in order to offer to the people of Galicia the opportunity to accuse heretics to a tribunal that is nearby, not to travel to Valladolid to do it. But more importantly, the Inquisition creates a new network of commissarios who generally are clerics. In general, they are parish priests, and they are not so much charged with the detection of heresy in their community. If they can, of course, they would do, but they serve as a kind of local representatives of the Inquisition, where people can easily denounce. It's very difficult. I want to denounce my neighbor, and I have to explain in a village of 50-60 people that I will go on a 3 days travel to the other side of the district and then come back. And people would ask, what is he going to do in Valladolid? Probably he's the one who has accused me, but he's the one, it's very easy to identify the people that are accusing you. Accusations before the Inquisition were anonymous, and the accused never, in theory, never knew who they were accused by. So, but if you're the only one leaving your village and 5 days later there's somebody arresting, then people knew, he probably went to the... So that's refraining accusations. With the commissario in the same village, you go by night, or you when you talk to him after mass or in whatever moment, it becomes very easy to make denunciations. And you have in the end a commissario every 4 or 5 miles. So it's a very dense network. So you have the emphasis on accusation. You have the infrastructure to receive those accusations. Now you have to be sure that people will be accusing. And then Inquisition uses several procedures, several techniques. The first one is socialization. They want people to internalize the norms and the values of society. And they do so by representing the inquisitorial policy as a policy of the whole society. Excuse me. I will come back to this in a few minutes. In the first place, civil authorities and the religious authorities start attending auto de face. Even the king, when he's present, will sometimes, not frequently, but some, there are auto de face that are presided by the king. And during this auto de face, and if the king is not present, his representative is present, they are obliged to swear an oath to the Inquisition. So everybody present, the public, general public, was also obliged for inhabitants of a city to participate in the auto de fe, could see that their own authorities are swearing loyalty to the Inquisition. The Inquisition starts putting emphasis on the sermons during the auto de fe. Long sermons, kind Fidel Castro sermons sometimes, hours of sermons during autos de fe. Autos de fe started at 7, 8 in the morning and then at 5, 6 in the evening. Sermons emphasizing the positive and the negative consequences of denouncing or not denouncing. The positive consequences being preservation of society. God will not punish Spanish society because of the presence of heretics in it. And of course, on the individual level, the relief of one's conscience. Your conscience is clear. That's an advantage. Negative consequences, when you don't denounce heresy, you're committing a deadly sin. And you end up in major excommunication and you put your soul in danger. And of course, you inflict damage on society too. Because God, at a certain point, will punish society in its whole. For example, the Armada has been interpreted by some as a punishment of God for the presence of heretics in Spanish society. Next step is to make people responsible of each other. And then you see that the Inquisition emphasizes very much that people would control the behavior of the people they are working with. That means that the parish priest will become responsible for the conscience of its parishioners. That's normal, no? But the head of the family will become responsible for everybody living under his roof. So when a heretic is detected in a family, the head of the family might be in problems too. They will ask them, why did you not report the presence of a heretic in your house? Employers will become responsible of their workforce. Innkeepers will become responsible of their guests. Hospitals will become responsible of their patients or their guests. Landlords will become responsible of their tenants. And even benefactors will become responsible of their beggars. Now, how do you facilitate this responsibility? You develop instruments to control the conscience of the people that are working with you, that are living in your house or you're giving money to. And that's this one. One of those instruments is the Bula de la Cruzada, what's a medieval tax to finance the war against the Moors, but still exists in the 16th, 17th century. It's not obliged to buy the Bula de la Cruzada, but if you don't buy it, then it's very suspicious. But in fact, then you're saying the war against infidelity, I'm not concerned with the war against heresy or infidelity. So you have really a moral obligation to buy a Bula de la Cruzada. So when you're looking for work, your future employer would ask you for this Bula de la Cruzada. Did you buy the Bula de la Cruzada this year? The second instrument is the so-called Cédula de Confesión. Catholic Church wants every Christian to confess every year with his parish priest. And then you get a certificate. Juan Romero confessed on the 1st of May in this parish, and this was the parish priest. And so again, you're traveling through Spain, and the innkeeper will ask you for this certificate. If you don't have the certificate, not only you don't get into the inn, but he will warn the local comisario, telling them there is somebody in the village not having a certificate of not having the cédula de confesión, and then you might be interrogated and maybe arrested. Another technique is stigmatization. You want people to be convinced that heresy, of course, is a bad thing. And stigmatization becomes very important in the second half of the 16th century too. In the first place, the autodefés are reorganized in a kind of theater place almost, and you have stages, you have stands, and it's almost a football stadium here, where every part of every participant has his place. You have here at the right the convicted persons, at the left you will have the authorities. I think this is Charles II. This is the Plaza Mayor in Madrid, and then the stand where the people they are reading the sentences of would sit down. Then you have here the general public. So autodefés were reorganized in order to stress stigmatization of heresies. At the beginning, every heretic, of course, has to abjure his sins. But at the beginning, it was a quite, it's not an informal moment, but it was a less important moment of autodefé. They did it after every sentence. So they would read sentence of Juan, and then he would abjure, and then of Luisa, and then she would abjure, and so on. In the second half of the century, they reorganize the whole autodefé, and they make a collective moment of abjuration, which becomes an important part of the autodefé itself. Other techniques are the what's the so-called inhabilidad. When you are a convicted person of the Inquisition, you are prohibited to carry out public functions. You are prohibited to exercise as tax farmers, physicians, pharmacists, barber surgeons. You are prohibited to carry arms, to ride horseback. You are prohibited to wear jewels made of gold, silver, pearls, coral, silk. So you are stigmatized, in short. Of course, if you're a farmer, you don't care about the jewels. But if you're an important person in society, well, it's kind of stigmatization. And then, of course, the San Benito, still preserving. San Benito didn't disappear, but the San Benito is used as a stigmatization. I'm sorry, this is another example of an autodefé in America. This is an autodefé in a village nearby Mexico City, San Bartolomé of Soltepec, at the beginning of the 17th century. This is a very small village, and even in these small villages, they stage autodefés as if they were a kind of theater play, which is really not the, the correct word, because, of course, things happening there were much worse than a theater play. But they stage, and the presence of the authorities on the right, of the local clergy on the left, they're all present, and of the heretics in the center. But what now? The auto, the San Benito, to return to San Benito, becomes an instrument to perpetuate the memory of the heretic. So the Inquisition will construct, will start constructing a memory of convicted persons. And through the Relaciones de Causas, some of you are studying them, I think. Relaciones de Causas are lists that every district has to send to the Council of Inquisition with all the persons convicted that year. So it's a kind of bureaucratic measure. It allows control over people condemned, but it is also a kind of perpetuation of memory, because those Relaciones de Causas, they are printed in the second half of the 16th century. They are printed, and you can buy them. You can go to the newspaper shop, and you can buy, or to the local printer, and you can buy your Relación de Causa, your list of convicted persons of that year. So their names are perpetuated. And second technique is the San Benito. San Benitos of convicted persons. So once you were punished and you ended your punishment, you could take them off. Now you are obliged to hang them in your parish church. And so everybody visiting your parish church will see that in this case Maria Álvarez, a few generations before, was convicted for hereje, it's always talk, hereje judaizante, in that year. So 1617. In 1717, the San Benito would still be there in this parish church. So the grandson of Maria Álvarez would be remembered of the faith of his ancestor, and the family would be stigmatized eternally. It's kind of, I compare it with those websites identifying pedophiles. Where do they live? And then, so allowing really control, social control informal social control in local societies. So the system evolves from a formal system of social control to a system of informal social control. People are surveilling each other, and they are doing that because they are convinced that what they are doing, that norms and values of that society are worth protecting. Now, of course, the only problem is the people ending up in the documents of the Inquisition are the ones who denounced. There are probably many more people who never denounced anybody and who never accused anybody, and maybe they didn't even care about the presence of heretics, but that we don't know because they didn't end up in the archives of the Inquisition. But then you see, at the end of the 16th century, a situation like this. Now, this is another example of San Benito. The printed Relaciones de Causas you could buy and would provide you with the names of all convicted persons. But at the end of the 16th century, you see this situation where maybe 10% of 10-15% of people are detected by the Inquisition and by the church itself, but where major part of the accused are accused by their neighbors, by their family members, by their employees, by people they meet. We have many cases where in a small village a Frenchman or an Englishman is traveling through Spain and he sits down at the fountain, he drinks some water, and people start to ask things. Ah, where do you come from? Ah, England. England. Oh, your queen or your king is a heretic. And then the discussion starts, and before you know, the Englishman is arrested by the Inquisition. So in the end, you get this system of informal social control, which is much more powerful than the Inquisition of formal social control, and is less inspired by fear than by the internalization of norms and values of this society. So that was more or less what I wanted to present you today. Thank you very much.